بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه أما بعد فإن خير الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدى هدى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Before we begin the topic, inshallah, was the practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And as that famous statement that the scholars used to say, and they continue to say, they say that the good, all of the good, is in following the Salaf. And evil, all of the evil, is in following the innovations of the Khalaf. You guys got to remember that. I see this masjid is filled up with a lot of you young people, maybe due to the fact that the lecture today is about hip-hop and hip-hop culture. So many of you have come out, although the inclement weather was out there and you had a rukhsa not to come. So I have to say this to you guys again. You have to remember this. The khair, the goodness in the deen, is in following the salaf. Abu Bakr, Uthman, Ali, and those companions, radiallahu anhum. And evil, all of the evil, is in following the innovations of the Khalif, the people came later on. Whatever the Khalif, latter generation of Muslims, whatever they said and whatever they do in the way of worshiping Allah and getting closer to Allah, if those companions were not upon it, then it's evil. Stay away from it. So in keeping with that, it was the way of the Salaf that after performing Hajj, when they came back from Al-Hajj and they met their community members, they used to encourage the people, hey guys, if you didn't make Hajj, hurry up and make Hajj. Another year has passed and you didn't make Hajj. And we performed Hajj this year by Allah's permission. And once again, we performed Hajj and there were people who were with us who performed Hajj for free. There were people with us, like a sister, revert sister, white sister. Her and her son performed Hajj. Where did she get the money from? Making dua to Allah Azza wa Jal. And the money came from here, from there. And she prioritized and she made Hajj. I'm going to tell you guys. You know how you feel when you perform, when you make and you fast Ramadan. Especially in the beginning of Ramadan, you really feel like, man, I'm a Muslim. I'm happy to be a Muslim. You feel righteous and religious. Hajj is like that. It is an ibadah that there is no other ibadah like it. So as the Prophet says, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, من أراد الحج فليتعجل. Anybody who wants to make Hajj, hurry up and do so. He told his companion, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, استمتعوا بهذا البيت قبل أن يرفع. Hurry up and come and enjoy this house before the Kaaba is raised up. We're dealing with Islamophobia today. A few days ago, there's a man, his name is Jeremy, what's his name from the Labour Party? Jeremy Corbyn. He was given the leadership of the Labour Party again. He gave a speech in Liverpool. And his speech was okay as far as political speeches go. He talked about anti-Semitism, being against the Jews, being against them, and being racist against them, and discriminating against them. In his speech, he also talked about the LGBT, lays, lesbian, gays, all that. He talked about homophobia. He was sensitive to them. He didn't talk about the Muslims. He didn't talk about the Muslims because they're not thinking about the Muslims. Recently, Shimon Peres, a war criminal, he killed people and committed crimes against humanity when he went into Lebanon and killed those defenseless Palestinians who in a refugee camp, he died the other day. The leaders of the world went to occupy Palestine and they spoke and they supported the situation. Some of them even wore the Jewish hat. The Jewish hat. Obama wore the Jewish hat and he praised that war criminal. Some people come to me and they tell me I should support Obama because he's African American. I say, hey, Obama killed a lot of Muslims. We don't make our decisions based upon color and things like that. Our decisions are based upon the Kitab and the Sunnah. Anyway, had a Muslim leader died, they wouldn't have went over there and put a shamag on a gutra or an imama. Why? Because they don't care about us. They don't care about us. So Islamophobia is going to get worse and worse and worse until the Kaaba is going to be destroyed. And it's not going to be there. So therefore, with that being the case, don't be a person who procrastinates. Get into your mind. I'm telling you, Shaitan wants to rip you off. He does not want you to taste the sweetness of al-Iman. So he makes you think, I'm going to make Hajj when I'm 40. I'm going to make Hajj when I get married. I'm going to make Hajj later. You weren't promised that you're going to see 40. And you weren't promised that the Kaaba is going to be there. People in Syria, they can't perform Hajj. People in Yemen. Yemen is close to Saudi Arabia. Mecca and Medina. People in Yemen, because of the attacks of the Houthis, they can't perform Hajj. You never know what's going to happen. So, therefore, from what the Salaf used to do when they came back and they met the community, they would tell the people, hey, get yourself together and start saving up your money and try your best to perform Hajj because you can do it. You can do it. When I first performed Hajj in 1986, it cost $1,000. This year, I know people, they were making Hajj, £8,000, £9,000. But if Allah wants you to perform Hajj, all he says is, being, it's going to happen. So I wanted to keep on top of that particular sunnah. Since this is my first talk given to you brothers on this day, Saturday, try to perform Hajj. And if you get the dough to go to Mecca and Medina in the month of Ramadan, فَيَحَبَّذَا, that's just as good, inshallah, because going to Allah's house is a tremendous opportunity. After that has been advertised, today's talk is in keeping with the series for this month. And the talk that was given to me is music and the hip-hop culture. And this thing can be tackled with from many angles. I could just come here and tell you, hip-hop is haram, let's all go home and that's it. But I'm not going to say that because I agree with some of the aspects of hip-hop. Let me say that in a full sentence and keep talking because my enemies, they'll cut and paste and they'll put Abu Sama said, I agree with hip-hop and that's it. I agree with some aspects of hip-hop that I'm going to tell you about. But for the most part, it's a problem. But in being Muslims, we have to be fair and we have to be just. We have to call a spade a spade. We take the truth for wherever it comes from. Our issue is to be upon the truth, to be the people of the truth, and not be concerned with being afraid of what people think and what people say and following the crowd. I heard recently in a WhatsApp message that I received that some young Muslim committed suicide because he was being bullied at school. Bullied in school. You young people have to have enough courage to be able to not follow the crowd, but to stand on what you believe and to say what you believe. So don't be one of those people who take positions just because everybody else did it. You get caught smoking. They say, well, you were smoking. Your answer is everybody else was doing it. That's the answer of a person who's not using his brain. Don't take positions and don't do things just because the crowd, they're taking those positions, they're doing those things. And this is something that led some people during the time of the Prophet ﷺ to die on shirk and kufr. As you all know, the story of his relative, story of Abu Talib, who helped this man, and the Prophet said on his dying bed, ﷺ, when the man was dying, all you got to do is say, La ilaha illallah. You never prayed, you never fasted, you haven't been to Hajj. Just say, La ilaha illallah. And inshallah, I'm going to get you into Jannah with that word. Just say, La ilaha illallah. And he looked at his bad friends. He looked at Abu Jahl and Abu Lahab, and they were looking at him as if to say, don't do it. Keep doing what we're doing. Don't do it. And then he looked to the Prophet and he said, no, I'm going to die on the religion of my forefathers. And he went to the hellfire as a result of that. And he heard the Prophet's dawah directly, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, we're not with the Nabi, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so it's a much difficult time. But don't be one of those people who just say things and do things because you want to be with the crowd. I want to split this talk into two divisions, categories. The first one is music, because it's simple and it's easy. Both talks are easy, both issues are easy, but I want to deal with the music first part. Deal with the part of music first. I have enough talks out there. I did enough khutbas, enough lectures to prove, I believe, that music is haram. And there is no such thing as halal music, as you're going to see, inshallah, from the tongue of the imams of al-Islam, who we claim that we follow, from the four imams of the madhahib. So instead of going over those issues again and giving the dalil again, I'll just tell you, go to YouTube and you can find my talks and other people's talks telling you that music is haram with the proofs from the Quran and the Sunnah and the statements of those companions and those people were taught by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wa radiyallahu anhu. So I'm not going to do that. Reinvent the wheel. But what I will do very quickly in talking about music is do something I didn't do before. And that is, I want to share with you people very quickly, you brothers and sisters, you shabab. I want to share with you very quickly those four imams who the Muslims claim that they follow. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, Al-Imam Malik, Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i, Al-Imam Ahmed, radiyallahu anhu, rahmatullahi alayhim rahmatin wasi'ah. Those imams, they all were in agreement that music was haram, all of them. They were in agreement that music was haram. And one of the things that you see when you perform Hajj is, you see the reality of our ummah when you perform Hajj. Some of the people in this country who are extreme and radical, I don't think they ever performed Hajj, to be honest with you. Because if you go to Saudi Arabia, if you go to Mecca and you see what the Muslims are doing, you can see that our community is in need of education, dawah. We're all in need of being motivated and inspired, learning our religion. Whenever Muslims come together, it's a crazy, it's a really weird phenomenon that whenever we come together, if there's a gate telling us to wait, as soon as that gate opens, instead of walking through the gate very easily, we rush through the gate. That's what we do at Hajj. We want to get on the train. When the doors open, everybody wants to get on the train and we crushed in there like sardines. If everybody would just relax, relax, take your time, it'd be easy. But that's how we are in the Muslim world. But as soon as we come back to Heathrow Airport, we get in that line and we just be walking real nice in that line. In Europe, we follow Nizam and Tartib. In the Muslim world, no, that's not the case. That's not the case. At the Hajj, you'll see that the imams took positions that they say you should do this at Hajj, you shouldn't do that. But their position may be a position that's tough for the pilgrim. This imam, my imam's position about this, do I have to stay in Muzdalifah all night into the morning or can I leave? Well, my imam said I can't stay. When these things happen, the person says, well, I'm not going to follow the madhhab in this case. I won't follow the madhhab in this case. I'm going to follow the madhhab whenever it's easy for me. and I'm going to cherry pick. And that's why we say, hey, we can't be blind followers of the imams. We take their positions when the haq is with them. And when the haq is not with them, we don't follow it. We can't cherry pick in this religion, as Allah commanded that we should enter into Islam wholeheartedly. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu udkhulu fis-silmi kaffatan wa la tattabi'u khutuwati ash-shaytan. Enter into the religion and take this whole religion. So as it relates to the statements and the positions of the imams, very quickly, as it relates to music, the four imams, try to remember this. First one, al-imam Abu Hanifa. Abu Hanifa, rahmatullahi alayhi, was the toughest of the four imams concerning music. So the majority of the people were Muslims in Birmingham. They come from Pakistan and Afghanistan and Bangladesh and these places. Majority of the masajid, people follow Abu Hanifa, rahmatullahi alayhi. We also follow al-imam Abu Hanifa and what he did and said, which was correct. And what he made mistakes in, we ask Allah to forgive him and to reward him one time. That's our position with all of the imams. But when it comes to music, remember this, the general rule, al-imam Abu Hanifa, he was tough when it came to people listening to music. If he knew that you listened to music, he wouldn't allow you to be a witness in the court of law. Someone needs you to witness for him, you're going to be his witness, and you came before Abu Hanifa. If someone wanted to disqualify your shahada, all he has to do is bring proof to the imam, this person listens to music. He said, you can't be a witness. Two witnesses for the nikah. You can't be one of them. Two witnesses in front of the judge. You can't be one of them. He was tough on this issue, saying that it was haram. For an example, very quickly, al-Imam Abu Hanifa, rahmatullahi ta'ala, as the great scholar Imam Abu Tayyib, he said he used to hate music and he saw it as being haram. And he said listening to music is a major sin. And this is the madhab of all of the people of Al-Kufa, where Imam Abu Hanifa came from. And although all of those Imams of Al-Kufa were not on his madhab, that was their position unanimously. Sufyan al-Thawri, Abdullah ibn Abi Shayba, and other than them. Concerning the issue of music, Al-Imam Abu Hanifa said, music, singing music is haram in every religion. The Jews say it's haram, Christians say it's haram, clearly Muslims say it's haram. So when they asked him what was his position about music, he said, music is haram in every religion. So if it's haram in the other religions, from the Bab al-Awla, it's more inappropriate for a Muslim to go around saying music is okay, it's halal. As you're going to see, that those people had to deal with some of the claims that we hear the people making today. So in concluding with Imam Abu Hanifa, who had the toughest stance against music, the great scholar and student of Ibn al-Taymiyyah, Ibn al-Qayyim, rahmatullahi ta'ala, he said about Imam Abu Hanifa, he said that his madhab was the toughest madhab as it relates to music. And the statements that he and his students and the scholars from that madhab said about music, they're the strongest statements as it relates to making music haram. And they were of the opinion that all instruments were haram. The drum, the flute, the duff, everything, even the duff. And the Prophet allowed us, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he allowed the women, he allowed the little girls, when there's a nikah, when there's a munasab, an occasion, celebration, he allowed little girls to hit the duff. And Imam Abu Hanifa said, no, the duff is haram. So we don't follow him in that. We don't follow that position. But I'm just mentioning this to you to let you know that their madhab and their imams and scholars were the toughest as it relates to that. So when we say we follow the imams, okay, why do we want to follow the imams in issues like raf'ul yadayn or not raf'ul yadayn, but when it comes to an issue of music, we start saying, no, but it's ikhtilaf. It's ikhtilaf. Secondly, is al-Imam Malik, rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi. One of the students of al-Imam Malik, Ishaq ibn Isa, rahmatullahi alayhi, said, I asked al-Imam Malik, about what some of the people of Al-Medina were doing. When some of the people of Al-Medina during his time, they said that listening to music and songs and things like that, listening to girls and women sing, some of the scholars said that this was permissible during their time. And this was one of the mistakes that some of the scholars of Medina were known for. So the scholar said, avoid that mistake concerning the people of Medina. Anyway, this man, Ishaq ibn Isa, he said, I asked Al-Imam Malik about this rukhsa that these scholars were saying. It's a concession. You can do it. If it calms you down, if it makes you feel okay, then it's okay. They said in that context. If you listen to music and it makes you, you know, tranquil and you get harmony in your life and it helps you to do a job, they said, okay, it's permissible. It's a rukhsa. So they want to know, Al-Imam Malik, what's your position concerning that fatwa, that rukhsa, concession? Al-Imam Malik, rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, said, innama yaf'alu dhalika indana al-fusaq. The only people who do this, listen to music, to us, the religious people, the students of knowledge, the people who we know in Medina, the only ones who do that are the people of fisq, a person who's a fasiq. That's it. As for the people of a taqwa, they don't listen to music. They don't need music to calm down, to relax. They have a job to do. They don't have to listen to music to get the job done. They don't have to do that. Another example of Al-Imam Malik, and there are many things that were mentioned, is what Ibn al-Qasim, one of the main students of Al-Imam Malik, he had said, put that book together, Al-Mudawwana. He mentioned that I asked Al-Imam Malik, and my question was concerning this issue about music. Al-Imam Malik read to me the ayat of the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, وَمَاذَا بَعْدَ الْحَقِّ إِلَّا الضَّلَالِ. And what is there after the truth? What is there except falsehood? You have truth and you have falsehood. Either the person is saying the haqq or the person is saying the batil. There's no in between. So when the man asked Al-Imam Malik about music, Al-Imam Malik read this ayat. Allah said, after the haqq, what is there except falsehood? He says, so I'm asking you, music, is it the haqq? Is it the haqq for you to ask me what's my position? Because Allah has established there are two types of kalam, the haqq, falsehood. Where does music lie? And I don't think anybody in his right mind is going to say music is the haqq. I don't think anybody in his right mind is going to say that. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, said, I left behind in Al-Iraq because he traveled many places. Went to Egypt, went to Al-Iraq, he went to Mecca, went to many, many places. He said, I left in Al-Iraq a thing that the people were doing. It was called a taghyir. A taghyir. He said that this taghyir, it was invented and introduced by the zanadiqa, the people who are zindiq, like heretical people. He said they're the ones who invented this in order to prevent the people from the Quran. At-taghyir, ikhwani, is equal today to Islamic music, Islamic hip-hop, Islamic rap. Back then, some of these people created this thing where they said, okay, we're going to sing songs and play music, but we're going to say Islamic lyrics to it. So when the song would go off, or they would make the song, they were saying Islamic things, Islamic themes with the music. They called that taghyir. They want to know, Al-Imam Shafi, what's your position and opinion about this music that people have created? And with the music, instead of singing about loose things and nasty things and bad things like hip-hop, they're going to talk about Al-Jannah and the Huru'een and loving Prophet Muhammad and the virtues of the companions, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, radiallahu anhu. They're going to talk about Islamic akhuwa, brotherhood, all those beautiful things. But it's going to be accompanied by music. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i said, this taghyir, it was introduced by the zanadiqa, the person who's a zindiq. The religion is clear, and here this person comes saying, okay, to guide the people to Al-Islam, I'm going to add music to the Quran.
I will lie, I heard that with my own ears recently. I heard that with my own ears recently. People who are singing right now, they're singing to Surat al-Fatiha. Surat al-Fatiha. Music, and the guy is rapping and singing Surat al-Fatiha. And for some reason, in some strange way, according to our Shabab, according to some of the dua today, this is okay. This is okay. So it was something that the scholars of the past, they had to deal with. Concerning this, Imam Shafi said about this, may Allah Ta'ala have mercy upon him. He said, music, singing, it is lahwun makruhun yushbihul batil. وَمَنْ اسْتَكْثَرَ مِنْهُ فَهُوَ الصَّفِيهِ تَرُدُّ شَهَادَتُهُ. He said this music singing, it is a form of wasting time, lahu, vain speech that is impermissible, and it is falsehood, batil. He said, whoever listens to it a lot, he is safih. He's challenged intellectually. You could say he's an idiot, he's stupid, but that's not politically correct to say somebody's stupid. Safih means like he's not smart, dumb. He said anyone who listens to it a lot is safih, and his shahada should be rejected. So listen, two imams, Al-Imam Abu Hanifa and Imam Shafi, both of them said, if a person is known to listen to music, we know that about him, then his shahada in the court of Islamic law is not listened to. Can't come and you can't be a witness. You can't be one of the witnesses whose name goes on the paper, the marriage certificate. So again, this is an example of how the Salaf were in the religion and how the Khalif are in their religion. Because if someone were to get married today, one of the witnesses is going to be a known drug dealer. The other witness is going to be someone who is a murderer. One of the witnesses is going to be a famous singer. And another of the witnesses will be a person who doesn't pray. Whereas those people back there, the best, the khayr, the good, is in following the salaf. And the evil is following the khalif and what they invented and introduced in the religion. Now, no doubt, don't get me wrong. There's a context to that. If we know this is the time that we're living in, then all of us are going to be products of this time. So no one should be walking around as if he's from the Malaika doing, and he's really a throwback from the time of the Salaf, and he's with a bunch of miscreants from the Khalif, and so therefore he's looking down at everybody. His nose is in the air, and he looks at us, and he gives dawah to us like that. We say, hey, man, we're living in a time where Islam is weak. This is a time of rahmah. This is a time of mercy. It's a time of gentleness. This is a time of giving us a break. You can't just come here and start blasting our youth about hip-hop culture and the effect and impact that hip-hop culture has had on them and it has on us right now. You can't come blasting them because this is not your generation. You have to deal with the people in a different way. So remember that, Ikhwani. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, Al-Imam Shafi'i, they looked at the one who listens to music as being the one who's a fasiq, who shouldn't be allowed to give a witness. Lastly, Al-Imam Ahmed, rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi. His son, Abdullah, the son of Al-Imam Ahmed, who was a scholar in his own right, and he used to ask his father all the time about this and this and that and this and that. So Abdullah wrote a book, Masail Abdullah li Abihi al-Imam Ahmed. The questions of Abdullah that he used to ask to his father. And other students of al-Imam Ahmed used to have books like this. Ibn Hani, many of them. They would ask him questions and write his answer down in books. Abdullah, the son of al-Imam Ahmed, he said, ask my father about al-ghina, about singing. Music. I asked him about this. And my father said, Al-ghina yuthbitu nifaq fil qalb. Ghina, music, singing, it plants the seed of hypocrisy in the heart of a person. Wa innahu la yu'jibni. And it's something that I'm not pleased with. I don't like it. Because look, Ikhwani, you all guys, all of you know that hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that when you have complete iman, full iman, he said, من أحب لله وأبغض لله وأعطى لله ومنع لله فقد استكمل إيمانه. Anyone who loves for Allah and he hates for Allah, he gives because of Allah and he refuses to give because of Allah, anyone who's like that, his iman is complete. So the Muslim has to love what Allah loves and he has to hate what Allah hates. Even if he finds himself liking something that's haram that Allah loves, within his own self, he knows he's wrong. He doesn't try to justify it. To know is bad and still do it, that's a bad thing. But to know is bad and then you try to make it okay, you try to give reasons and say it's okay, it's a problem. The point here is, the Muslim has to love what Allah loves, hate what Allah hates. Allah loves justice. Allah loves cleanliness. Allah loves virtues. So we should love that. Allah loves a tawheed. He loves that you worship him alone. And he doesn't love shirk. So when a Muslim comes and he's in opposition to tawheed, he's in opposition to the people of a tawheed, he's in opposition to a dawah, to a tawheed, then something's wrong with him. Allah hates innovation. He hates it. But the Muslim comes and he loves innovation. No, he has to be repelled by it, not like it. Allah loves unity amongst the Muslims. He doesn't love for the Muslims to be divided. So if a person is dividing the Muslims unnecessarily, something's wrong with the equation. Their dawah is one and the same. The dawah to the kitab and the sunnah, according to the understanding of the salaf of the ummah. But we have different scholars. You got that scholar and I have that scholar. He takes a position. I don't like you because of the position that you and your scholar took. You don't like me because of the position me and my scholar took. And as a result of that, we divide amongst ourselves on these issues. Allah doesn't love that. So the point here is, why did Imam Ahmed say that music, it puts hypocrisy in your heart? Because if a person is listening to this music and the music is saying things like, you know, I'm going to kill him. And then I'm going to bring him back to life again and kill him again. And then I'm going to throw his mother out of the window. And then I'm going to take him and put him under a car. And I'm going to go over his head with the wheel. And then I'm going to send him. He's going to go to the hospital. He's going to be DOA, you know, dead on arrival. And a person is listening to that and he's tapping his feet and shaking his head. Something's wrong with you. Same thing. Any kind of music. Hollywood, Bollywood, the movies that we watch, that stuff that we listen to, not just hip-hop, some of those R&B songs that we grew up with, little R&B, they be saying all kinds of stuff. The man is trying to show his love for the woman. He's trying to show he loves this woman, not even his wife. So he says, heaven must be missing an angel because you're down here with me right now. Can heaven miss an angel? That's a statement of kufr. So if a person is listening to that and it makes them feel a bit, that's nifaq. That's what Al-Imam Ahmed meant. When you listen to these songs, Pakistan, Somali, Sudan, wherever you go, music is one of the biggest weapons of a shaitan. That's why one of the delils of what makes music haram is the ayat where Allah Azzawajal mentioned to shaitan, go ahead, Allah gave him respite. Shaitan said, because you misguided me, just give me respite. Allah said, you are from those who have been given some respite. I'm not going to punish you right now. Allah said, go forth and seduce them with your voice. The scholar said, seduce them with your voice is music. So every single culture has this fitna of music. Moroccan, Algerian, Nigeria, everywhere. Alaska, wherever you go. I'm going to share this with you guys. Growing up, I remember it used to be real cold in New York. I remember it used to be so cold. You wake up and the window was frosty. It was so cold. And we were getting ready to go to school. Every morning, my mother would put on Diana Ross, Motown. I grew up listening to that stuff. So right now, if I heard one of those songs right now, it makes me feel a particular way. Like those Christmas songs. I don't believe in Christmas. I don't buy into it. I don't practice it. But when you grow up listening to that stuff, it becomes a part of you. That's why I say every year we have to do a lot on the day of the Eid to compete with Christmas and all of those other celebrations for our kids. We have to make the Eid something that is big. I am against having an Eid in a small little masjid or in a small little park over here by ourselves where it's going to be 60, 80,000 Muslims coming together trying to show the outer community, here we are, as I mentioned in my last khutbah here, that they didn't put up. Here we are, and we ain't going nowhere. Gongo Sharif, I don't agree with what's being taught in there. Zil Quran, I don't agree what's being taught in there. They are brothers, though. Those masjids, when you drive up St. Saviour's Road, and you look at that masjid on St. Saviour Road, Zil Quran, says to people, hey, these Muslims are here. That roundabout by Gumgu Sharif. When you drive around me and you see that masjid, people look at that masjid and they say, these Muslims are here. 80,000 people going for the Eid. That's our way of telling these people as well, we are here. Our religion is here. So the point here, Ikhwani, is everybody has this issue of music. It's one of the big weapons Shaitan has led people astray from time immemorial up into now. So therefore, if a person wants to listen to music, he should know that he runs that risk of having that nifaq in his heart. Lastly, concerning Al-Imam Ahmed, one of his students, Abu al-Harith, rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, said, I asked Al-Imam Ahmed about at-taghyir. What is taghyir? Taghyir, the people doing their time. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, do their time. Where they started making music, but they made it to Islamic lyrics and themes. And they said that it causes the heart to become soft. So this man, Abu al-Harith, he said, I asked Al-Imam Ahmed about at-taghyir and the claim that the people say that at-taghyir, it causes the heart to be muraqqaq. It causes the heart to be soft and affected. Makes you think about Allah and so forth and so on. He said, what's your opinion, Al-Imam Ahmed? He said that Al-Imam Ahmed said, this taghyir is a bid'ah. وَلَيْسَ مِنَ الْإِسْلَامِ فِي شَيْءٍ And it has nothing to do with the religion of Islam. There is no such thing, no such thing as Islamic hip-hop. No such thing. So you know that famous tune that came out, Happy, and the people all over the world were singing it because Muslims have to follow. We have to copy whatever the kuffar are doing. We have to. If it's trending, we have to jump on board. So you have Algerians doing Happy. Moroccans doing Happy. You have everybody across the globe doing this thing, dancing. Then you have the Muslims in the UK doing it. Sisters in hijab. And people will say, hey, don't be sour grapes, man. Lighten up. Relax. Islam is easy. Just take it easy. Don't be like an old, you know, old grumpy old. Don't be like that. No, this is the problem, guys. And you parents, this is part of the challenge that I'm telling you guys about. Recently, a young Muslim lady from America has been acknowledged, and she will be rewarded and awarded by Playboy magazine for her accomplishments in her profession. She's a lady who's, you know, doing the media and stuff like that. So she's done a lot of stuff. So they want to acknowledge her. So she's the first Muslim with hijab on who's going to be acknowledged by Playboy. How many of you heard about that? How many of you heard about that? This thing is all over the social media. Now, the weird thing is, Muslims sitting down debating and discussing, is this permissible? Is it not permissible? Is this permissible? Is this not permissible? Like the Imam said, Allah Ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, فَمَاذَا بَعْدَ الْحَقِّ إِلَّا الضَّلَالِ After the truth, what is there except falsehood? Can you imagine Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam condoning and endorsing a Muslim lady going to a magazine like that to have her picture in that magazine? Now, I'm not trying to expose the girl and I ain't judging the girl. I'm talking about our community.
and the condition that in 10 years, 5 years, Allahu A'lam, your kids and my kids, these kids, Al-Islam is going to be something else if we don't do something about it. Now listen to me now. I'm talking about music, but you know how I do. Anytime you hear about a poll and the results of the poll says that Donald Trump is winning. Listen to the general rule. Never ever believe 100% in any poll. The only polls that we believe in all together, 100%, are the polls of Al-Islam. The believers are going to Jannah. Non-believers are going into hellfire. 100%, that's what the polls said. No doubt about it. But the polls in the dunya, never ever believe 100% any poll, because they're subjective. When they ask questions, the way the question is asked. Who was asked the question? The educated will answer the question different from the illiterate. The rich will answer a question different from the ones not rich. African American is going to answer the question different from someone who's from Britain. The one who's in the north will be different from the south. The woman, different from the man. The Arab, different from... That's how the polls are. So the one who is conducting the poll can almost always get the answer that he wants. So don't believe it. But there are some polls that are credible, respectable, like Pew, P-E-W, and like Gallup, G-A-L-L-O-P. They're pretty credible. But even them, same thing. They did a poll with these people, and they polled 1,000 Muslim kids who are in the university. They wanted to see if the Muslim community, the Muslim intelligentsia of tomorrow, how are they thinking? Are they liberal? Are they back in the Stone Ages? So they asked them a number of questions. One of the questions was, in your religion, you Muslims, you people out there, do you believe that the Jews and the Christians are in paradise? 1,000 Muslim kids in the university were asked this question. 57% of them said they're going to be in Jannah. The Yahud and the Nasara. Because Allah said in the Quran, in الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَالَّذِينَ هَادُوا وَالنَّصَارَ وَالصَّابِئِينَ مِنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَعَمِلِ الصَّالِحَةِ فَلَهُمْ أَجْرُهُمْ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ وَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يُحْزَنُونَ. Verily, those people who believe, and those people who are Jews, and those people who are Christians, and those people who are Sabi'een, those people who believe in Allah on the last day, and they do good works, they're going to get their reward with their Lord. And Yawmul Qiyamah, they won't be sad, nor will they have any fear. So Allah said in this ayat that they're going to be in Jannah. Now, if you came and you were a new Muslim and you read that ayat for the first time, I can see you understanding it like that. But what are you going to do with Surah Al-Fatiha? Ihdina Surat Al-Mustaqim, Surat Al-Ladina An'amta Alayhim. And not the Surah of those people who you're angry with and those who are Dalim. So you got to understand that ayat in these ayats. So many ayats telling us of the kufr of the Christians, the kufr of the Jews. Point here is, 57% of our Shabab are believing this simple issue. We just fasted the month of Ramadan, akhi, 18 and a half hours we fasted. And the Jews and the Christians didn't fast not a day. We're going to go to Jannah, they're going to go to Jannah. We just made Hajj, and it was so hot at Mina and Arafat, going around the Kaaba, people were pushing us and this and that, and our feet hurt. To this very day, my wife told me, hey, can you go to the store, get some eggs? Right when she said that, 2 weeks after Hajj, my feet started morphing. Because we walk so much. But after you walk and you get home, you feel like, hey, alhamdulillah, I did something for Islam. I made jihad. I'm not just sitting down doing nothing the way our lives are here. You go to that Hajj, yes, while you're going through it, ask Dr. Abu Hanifa. The brothers who are here. Brother over there, Ishfaq, while we're going through it, it's tough. Yes, it's tough. But after it's all over,
you start to wish, man, I wish I could go back and do that again because I feel like I did something for my religion. But anyway, we go through all of that. Muslims go through all of that Hajj. 1.3 million people at the Kaaba, going around the Kaaba. And the Jews and the Christians, they don't have to do anything. They sit in a bar and drink khamr, don't pray, don't it. And we're all going to Jannah. But this is what is happening with the mindset of the Muslim community. So the Muslim leadership, we have to recognize and realize we have a big challenge, man. We got some serious issues. And for our dawah to be stuck on stupid the way it is with how people are behaving, I say, hey, man, let's leave these people alone and let's just keep doing what we're doing and try to address the challenges of our community and help Islam, all of the Muslims here in the West, all of them, people on our dawah, people not on our dawah, because we want al-Islam to spread. Real Islam, the only Islam. But under that umbrella of real Islam are some of our brothers and sisters who don't know for one reason or another. But let's move Islam forward and leave the people who just want to waste time and be theoretical and divided and hate, spread hatred. Leave that stuff. So with this issue, Ikhwani, and the statement of these four imams, especially Al-Imam Abu Hanifa being the toughest one as it relates to music, and Al-Imam al-Shafi and Imam Ahmed talking about at-taghyir, which is similar to what these people are calling Islamic hip-hop and all of this stuff like that, we should know that those four imams unanimously were against this and their students. Now, as it relates to hip-hop culture, a lot can be said about hip-hop culture, brothers. I'm just going to direct you, especially you parents, man, to two heavyweight intellectuals from the African-American community. If you really want to know about the evil and you really want to know about the effect and the impact of hip-hop on society and so forth and so on, then go back and check out some of the things that Dr. Boyce, like Joyce, but instead of a JB, Boyce Watkins, Dr. Michael Eric Dyson, these people study this stuff, put it out there for sociologists and people like that to appreciate what's going on, because this topic is not just a small topic. You just come and see it's haram. There are many aspects of the hip-hop culture. So first thing that we want to mention, because some of you, like you older brothers especially, you may not know that hip-hop is just not music. And that's why I said to you, there are some aspects of hip-hop culture that I support. In the 70s, before most of you kids were born, when hip-hop started, the whole culture started, it started as a result of it being a means and a way that the marginalized, the disenfranchised, the underprivileged, the poor African-Americans and Latinos had a way to express themselves, an art form to express themselves. That's what it originally started as. People in the Bronx, New York, and other boroughs in New York, those places have a lot of issues, social issues, that snap out and snuff out and strangle the life of the human being. Growing up in the ghetto is a problem. It's anti-human being. And there is systemic racism in America and in this country, but it's not as bad as America. Black people are getting killed left, right, and center. And if it wasn't for Allah, as I mentioned, and smartphones, we wouldn't have known about it, because this stuff been going on a long time. And even though they will catch the thing from beginning to end, the police officer is still going to get off, because the system itself makes this happen. I was stopped coming into this country after Hajj. They stopped me under the terrorism law. They have the right to stop anyone, and they can keep anyone for up to 6 hours if you're traveling out or in of any of the borders of the UK. They can stop you. They only stop Muslims. They don't stop anyone else. They stop you. Come And they start asking you questions. They don't know who you are. They start asking you questions. Depending upon where you're going and your answers will determine how that interview is going to go. When I came back, and I was tired. I want to see my babies. I have 9 brothers waiting for me outside. So they have to come with me to Birmingham. They kept me in there 3.5-4 hours. I was so upset. And I was aggressive with them because I was so upset. Stopping me, I'm coming from Hajj, I'm tired, you know who I am. The point is, I was allowed to express myself like that. Because here the police, they have more rahmah on you. Doesn't mean there's no racism. And that doesn't mean that the police never killed people. They killed people here too in Brixton and so forth and so on. But it's not like in America. They stopped me in America. I'm not going to say anything to those people because they will crack your head wide open. And you don't know, and your parents won't know what's going on. So there is this problem in the ghetto that creates a lot of other problems. So these people who came from the ghetto, they came up with this hip-hop culture. What does hip-hop culture consist of? A lot of stuff. Most of it is all bad, but some of it is positive. They have the music itself. They have what they call MCing. The guy's the MC. I'm not going to go into that. The guy who is the B-box. B-boxing, you have that. You have break dancing. That was back then. You have graffiti. Graffiti art. I support that. Which graffiti? I don't support the graffiti where the guy goes to someone's private property and he puts some stuff all over his thing. I don't support that. But if a person was given, like in many parts of London, an opportunity, the ability to make a mural or something like that. Like that guy Banksy. They make this stuff and it's nice. I think that's okay. As long as there's no images and it's not a message that's negative. Right here in Birmingham. That brother, I think his name is Ali. Ali was drawing this thing in Palestine. Or was it Iraq? When a guy threw the shoe at George Bush. Throwing the shoe at George Bush was not correct because George Bush is a leader and the Muslims are there with him. And we shouldn't act like that, especially when the world is looking. But it's really hard as a Muslim when we saw that the shoe missed, though. Although it wasn't the right thing to do. No, it's hard as a Muslim. So that brother, he drew that. Now, we're not talking about the size of the arm and the disproportion of the image. We're not talking about that. But when you go by that thing, although it's being washed away right now, every time I see that thing, it reminds me of Iraq and what's going on in Iraq. And another thing I can't fail to bring this to your attention. Ikhwani, the Muslims in Syria today, yesterday, these last few days, while we're listening to hip-hop and while we're acting the way we're acting, Muslims are living some real tough, difficult stuff right now. Bombs are being dropped on them by the Russians, by the Americans. They make no distinction between hospitals, private homes, refugee camps. They don't care. And they're killing our people left, right, and center. And this is why I always say, America and the West, you are not the moral authority for me. You can speak for some of these other Muslims if you want, but I don't care what you say about what's barbaric and what's not barbaric. Because now in Russia, all they have to do is say, no, we didn't do it. That's it. They bombed a convoy bringing food to those people who need it. And they killed innocent people who were out there trying to help people. And then when America does it, they say, we didn't do it. That's it. And then the world doesn't hear about it after that. We don't hear anything about it. So what those people are going through right now, we can't fail to remember and put everything into context. May Allah Azza wa Jalla give the people of Halab his assistance. May he help all of the Muslims who are under the yoke of oppression and all they have is Allah. That's it. Because the Ummah is really failing these people in many ways. So the least that we can do is to make dua for them. From hip-hop as well, Ikhwani is spoken word. Spoken word is a person getting up and taking words and putting them together and saying his ideas. And Islam, that's from Islam. That's from Islam. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came from the Arabs, and poetry was one of the main characteristics that the Arabs are described with. And that's why when the Prophet came with his religion, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he utilized some of his companions who were poets. And they used to make jihad with poetry, like his companion Hassan ibn Thabit. Not Hassan. Hassan ibn Thabit. The Kuffar were there, and they had the best poets of Quraysh, and they were challenging Hassan ibn Thabit, challenging the Muslims, challenging Prophet Muhammad. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told Hassan ibn Thabit, go and make jihad against them, and may the Ruh al-Qudus be with you. May Jibril assist you in that issue. And he went and he had a battle with them. He had a battle with them using poetry. So from hip-hop is spoken word. And that's beautiful. I've been exposed to some really talented people. So it's not all of hip-hop that I'm against, but it's the hip-hop culture that has proliferated itself today. That's the problem today. Like they said, hip-hop is dead, meaning when hip-hop first started, it was a form of expression. It was people trying to, you know, rise out of that problem that they were living. Now hip-hop is dead because it's about consumerism and it's about oppression. Hip-hop now, the lyrics of hip-hop, what they say, what they believe, the imagery of hip-hop, the person thinks being successful is wearing a gold this or platinum this. And we have many Muslims who have been affected by this. Many Muslims from the youngsters in our community. The way they dress, the way they talk. People following America. America seems to be, I don't know, the place that set all the trends. America. We got to America. If it's from America, it's okay. No, a person should try to be unique in his individuality and not follow other people other than Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when it comes to the religion of Islam. So the misogyny, the chauvinism, the lyrics that are nasty and evil, obviously break dancing, you're going to dance to music, all of that stuff is not permissible. All of that consumerism and all of what hip hop has become today in our religion. People who give their ears to hip-hop, they're being controlled. Your emotions are being controlled and your thinking is being controlled. In concluding, someone may argue with me and they may say, yeah, but just as you acknowledge that there is spoken word in hip-hop and that's part of the culture and that is not against Islam, as long as a person is not saying things that are haram and it's not accompanied by music, do you not also accept that there are conscious hip-hop artists, people who speak about issues and messages, and also the hip-hop musicians are doing a lot of things for cultural change as well, social change as well. Isn't that true? I say, some people, I think they're trying to be conscious, but again, accompanied with the music, with the people who are around them, with what hip-hop has become today, I can't see Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam coming back and endorsing hip-hop. Can't see Isa ibn Maryam coming back, salawatullahi wasalam alayhi, endorsing this culture, endorsing what these people are doing. So with that being the case, Ikhwani, what we should do is, instead of allowing the seeds of hypocrisy to be planted in our hearts with these lyrics that are decadent and detrimental to our growth and our development, spiritually especially, we should engage ourselves in what Allah Ta'ala has given us in the halal recreation. And there are many things in halal recreation. So this week, since the talk is after Salat al-Isha, I'll give you guys, if you have, inshallah, 15 minutes of Q&A, bi'idhnillah. So if you guys have any questions concerning what we put forward today, you can put your the question across now. Barakallahu fikum wa ahsanallahu ilaykum. Hal indakum shay?
If you're raising your hand, you got to raise your hand up higher because I don't have my glasses. Anybody got any question? Tafaddal ya akhi.
In the Bible, where does it say in the Bible that music is haram?
I don't know where it says in the Bible that music is haram. And I myself didn't claim that the Bible said that music is haram. But instead, the imam that we mentioned, Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi ta'ala alayhi, when he was asked about the rule of the music, one of those times that he answered that question, he said, music is haram in all of the adyan. So that's what the imam said. I can't say that. I'm not an expert on the Bible, and nothing comes to my mind that would allow me to say that. But I would say this, akhi, that principle that I told you guys about, al-khayru, kullul khayr, fittiba' man salaf, wa-sharru kullu shar, fittida'i man khalaf. All of the good is in following the salaf, and the evil is in following the innovations of the Khalif. This principle is also true with the Jews and the Christians. They are Salaf. When Isa ibn Maryam came to the Nasara, they were the best. The ones who were at the Ma'ida with him, his helpers, his Hawariyun, they were the best. None of them said Isa is the son of Allah. They kept the laws, they kept the Sabbath, they did what they were supposed to do. As time went on, the Khalif of the Christians, they came up with, Jesus is the Son of God. So if music was haram somewhere in their religion or their book, and Imam Abu Hanifa knew that ayat or whatever, that verse in their book, if it was haram, you can't tell Christians today that this is haram, because part of worshiping with them is music. You're not going to get too far in a black church telling them music is haram. They're not going to listen to you then. Because that was the favorite part of the service. Because when the man was talking, we went to sleep. We used to say, what is he talking about? What is he talking about? But as soon as it was time to sing and dance, and that's when it was like, it was on at that point. We turned up then. But the Salaf from the Jews, they were the best. The people with Musa, when he went on the mountain, 70 people were with him. They were the best, the aslaf. And then later on, after many, many years, now the new Jews, they're the worst. The first Muslims, the best. Now the new Muslims, the khalaf. We changed many aspects of our religion. So Ibn Qasim, barakallah fiqh, I don't know this verse from the Bible. Any more questions, ikhwani? Fadl ya akhi, kalimullah. That's a really good point about how we find many famous people having an impact on the minds and the hearts of the youngsters of our community and the people who should count, like the ulama of Islam. We don't give them any consideration or any concern. One of the big fitnas that dawah is going through right now is with the dawah men that we have, where an individual is famous from the internet, for an example. So because he was a singer or a rapper or something, whatever, when he becomes a Muslim and he starts doing things, he'll get a million hits or so many followers, and that's a proof to the people that it's okay. And this is really one of the big fitness that we're dealing with.
So with what's been going on recently with all this drama, with refutations, this stuff that's been going on, this I've been asked many times, I don't think the right way is for imams in this country, for an example, to put those brothers on blast, those hip-hop guys who come into Islam, people who are doing, what do they call that? Islamic hip-hop? You know, some of these famous guys. I don't believe we should put them on blast and refute them and do khutbas on them. I believe we should reach out to those guys. We should reel them in. Talk to their mind. Talk to their hearts. Talk to their spirits. Get them to understand, first of all, academically, you know you don't amount to a lot because you're a new Muslim, for an example, and you know you don't know much about the religion. So academically, we present the issue to them. Make sure the person can't hide behind, but it's ikhtilaf. Make sure he can't hide behind that. And then we give him love and support. Let the person know, you're going to be responsible, man, for everybody who follows you in that thing. So instead of ostracizing them and putting them on blast in Front Street, I think we need to reach out to those guys and pull them in close and give them love and educate them, uplift them. Because now that same voice that was being used for the misguidance of people can be used to tell the people, hey, this is not the way. This is not the way. So it is one of the big challenges, man, that as the Prophet prophesied about it, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said about the time, yawm al-qiyamah, when it comes, yuntiqu fiha al-ruwaybida. The ruwaybida will speak about the affairs of the people. They said, who are the ruwaybida, Ya Rasulullah? Who are the ruwaybida? He said, rajul tafih yatakallam fi amr al-amma. He is the ignoble, insignificant man talking to the general masses about issue. This guy is a brand spanking new Muslim and he's giving dawah to people who don't even know what he's talking about. When we went to Hajj, there was a famous hip-hop guy or British, I think he's British. I don't see any names. But there was a famous rapper who performed Hajj. When I was in Hajj, I was receiving the WhatsApp picture that he was in Hajj. So hope I can meet that brother. Just like the ambassador of Britain to Saudi Arabia. He became a Muslim and he performed Hajj. So we want to meet these people so that we could talk to these people, try to help these people to the best of our ability, expose them to the sunnah. Because contrary to what people will have you to believe, being on the sunnah is not exclusive. Exclusivity is just mine. Just me and the brothers who are with me. I can't go to Gumgul Sharif if they ask me to go. No conditions. I can't go because they're people of innovation. What are you talking about? How is this religion going to spread and this dawah going to spread if we don't take it to people in the correct way? I'm not saying open-ended. So we want to reach out to these brothers like that because we know the way human beings are, like Umar. Prophet Muhammad knew, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if Umar became a Muslim, it's going to help al-Islam. He's a personality. And if he becomes a Muslim, people are going to say, the Muslims are going to say, yes, we're stronger today. So when you have people like this embracing Islam, it's going to have an effect and an impact on our youngsters. So what we got to do? I think we have to be people who take the initiative and get engaged and step to these brothers to help them to come to the right way. And Allah knows best. So if anybody is in contact with people like that, you guys got to holler at us and let us try to help the situation. Any more questions, ikhwani fillah? Okay, then. We're going to stop now and ask Allah Azza wa Jalla first and foremost to have mercy on all of us, forgive all of us, open up the door for all of you guys to perform Hajj next year, inshallah Azza wa Jalla, and that he helps us to disconnect ourselves from listening to music. هذا وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين.